Soy palma que en la brisa le baila solo a la mar, porque con tu caricia sé que no puedo contar. Si llega la cigüita para en mi rama cantar, abro mi ventanita, con ella salgo a volar. Vuelan fotografías por mi cabeza y en blanco y negro, mi corazón ahogándose, cuestionándome tu te quiero. Tanto que me decía que me quería, dulce veneno, la confusión quemándome, remendándome tu deseo.
Good morning, folks. Thanks for joining. We're going to get started in just a couple minutes while we wait for people to join. While we wait, just enjoy the music as we wait to get started.
Soy palma que en la brisa le baila solo a la mar, porque de tu regazo sé que no puedo arrimar. Si una mariposita viene a mi patio a pasear, juego con sus alitas, con ella salgo a volar. Bailan fotografías por mi cabeza y en blanco y negro, mi corazón ahogándose, cuestionándome tu te quiero. Tanto que me decía que me quería, dulce veneno, la confusión quemándome, remendándome tu deseo. Soy palma que en la brisa le baila solo a la mar, porque con tus amores sé que no puedo contar.
All right, folks. Good morning, everyone. And welcome to our Municipal Net Zero Playbook webinar. My name is Megan Aki, and I'm the Clean Energy and Climate Systems Manager at MAPC. And I am so excited to be sharing with you today our new resources that our team has developed for municipalities. So before we get started with today's material, I want to let folks know that we are recording today's webinar. The recording will be available after on our website. And by continuing, you're consenting to participate in a recorded event, and the transcript and recordings will be considered public record. A few other notices just in terms of our use of Zoom today. We ask that you please only use the chat feature for messaging the Zoom host with any technical difficulties that you might have. So if at any point you can't hear the audio or you have an issue viewing the screen share, let us know in the chat. We ask that you submit any questions that you have during the webinar using the Q&A feature. So you should be able to see that in your little Zoom menu, either at the top or bottom of your screen. You'll be able to ask questions throughout. So please add those as they come to you as we're going through the presentation. And the MAPC team that's on the line will do our best to get back to your questions in the Q&A, so you'll be able to see questions that have been asked and then questions that have been responded to by MAPC staff. We'll also have an opportunity at the end of the presentations after our municipal panel to have some live Q&A directly with the municipal staff who've joined us today. We do have a pretty large audience today, but we're going to do our best to try to get to as many of your questions as we can. And if you do have questions that remain unanswered at the end of the webinar, you're always welcome to reach out to staff at MAPC, and we can help you out with those questions. So to give you a quick peek into what to expect today, after a brief introduction, we're going to do a few poll questions just to get to know who's joining us today for the webinar. So excited to see over 175 people tuning into the webinar. And then we'll dive into the playbook with some background on why we developed it and how to use the guiding frameworks that support the playbook. Then MAPC staff are going to provide a rapid round of presentations, highlighting each main chapter from the playbook. And then lastly, we'll close with a panel featuring several municipal staff across the region and their work implementing actions that are highlighted in the playbook. So to start us out, I wanted to share a little bit more about MAPC, or the Metropolitan Area Planning Council. We're the regional planning agency that serves the 101 cities and towns in the greater Boston area. Our mission is to advance smart growth and municipal collaboration throughout our planning work with municipalities. Our clean energy department supports municipalities on a wide variety of project areas, from regional procurement and implementation of energy projects, climate and energy planning and policy advocacy work, and direct technical assistance to your communities on grant writing, project implementation, and a lot of other areas as well. Over the past 4 years, we've worked to build out our area of practice with communities on net zero planning, and our team in the Clean Energy Department and across MAPC can support you and your municipality with everything from data analysis to inform your net zero plan, planning and engagement, and goal setting. And now I'm going to pass it over to our Clean Energy and Climate Fellow, Frances Morales-Suarez, to lead us through some opening activities just to get to know all of you a little bit better.
Hi, everyone. So I'm going to be sharing my screen soon, but first let's go through the instructions for using poll anywhere. So as Megan noted, we'll be doing an icebreaker poll activity, and we really appreciate you joining us today and would like to learn more about who's with us this morning. And we are going to be using poll everywhere for this activity, and the instructions are here. So if you are on the web, go to pollev.com/MAPC poll so that you're able to respond to the activity. And if you'll be using your phone and joining by text, you can text MAPC poll to 22333 and text in your messages through there, and you'll be able to respond to all three questions through here as well. So I'm going to share my screen. All righty, so I'll wait a bit to see the things, the different responses coming in. Seeing a lot of different places on here, which is great, from the region. So again, if you just joined, at the top of the screen, you can see the instructions for getting into Poll Everywhere and putting in your responses for where are you joining us from, city, town, or state. So a lot of responses populated on the screen. This is great. So Massachusetts, front and center. See, we have a lot of folks from Boston, different cities in the area and towns, Cambridge. Ooh, we have New York. Arlington, Bolton, Natick. Okay, it's great to see so many people from all over the region. Philadelphia. Princeton, Framingham, Ithaca. That's awesome. It's great to have all of you here. Okay. I think not seeing much more coming in. So take a good look at the screen. So many different places that people are joining us from. I think now I'm going to move on to the next question. Sorry, folks, it's taking a while to load. All right, yeah, so let's move on to the next one. So what best describes your role in your community? There are several options for you to choose from. If you choose other, feel free to write in the chat your role if you'd like. So I see a lot of responses coming in. Many who are local volunteers, that's great to see. Municipal staff in sustainability, energy, and climate roles, and also in other planning or other departments. 12% elected officials. Ooh, a lot of regional and state government staff. Yeah, we have a lot of local volunteers. That's great. This is a great group. I'm glad that you're all here to learn more about the playbook, which was designed to be helpful for you in your respective roles. Okay, so we have so far 17% municipal staff in sustainability, clean energy, climate roles, 16% municipal staff in planning or other departments, 27% local volunteers, 10% elected officials, 18% regional and state government staff, and 12% other. And again, feel free if you chose other to put in what your roles might be in the chat so others can know. All right, a bit more responses coming in. Okay, I'm gonna move on to the next one. Thanks so much for everyone who's participating. Okay, so the last question is, what are you hoping to learn today? So in a sentence or two, let us know what you would like to learn today, what you'd like to have learned by the end of the webinar. Loving the questions. Also can put in keywords or themes that you'd like to hear more about. Some folks want to know what's next, what the playbook is all about, overview of MAPC's approach doing this work, how to write a climate action plan for our town, policy recommendations for state and local officials. We have some great responses coming in. MAPC best practices for municipal action towards net zero. We'll definitely be learning a lot about that today. Yes, how MAPC can help your communities, how you can help your communities, how you can replicate in Southeast Pennsylvania. It's awesome. Definitely made the net zero playbook in mind so that other folks in different communities are able to use those strategies and best practices for their communities. How to get to net zero. More techniques and tools to facilitate net zero planning. Next steps recommended for achieving electrification net zero goals. How the playbook will help you prioritize. The general overview of the playbook and how to implement it at the local level. Some great responses coming in. Thank you, everyone. Yes, financial options for renters and low-income folks. How to implement the climate plan locally. Practical, affordable ways to really get to net zero, actionable solutions that can be applied to both residential and municipal. Okay, some awesome responses. The tools towns can use to approach net zero, and how other towns are aiming for energy reductions. Yeah, definitely, it's great to be able to learn from what others have done as well. How to implement net zero climate action plan. how municipalities can work together to combat the climate crisis. Yes, definitely collaboration is very important. What's new and how to address transportation and net zero? How to educate and unify the city in green energy solutions and how to execute this? Yes. Best practices for community-wide GHG reductions and strategies for your community. Many, many great responses, and I'm sure we'll learn about many of these things today. Assistance and guidance and funding for the NZB new school. All right, thank you everyone for participating and for all these great responses. Keep them coming. We'll definitely keep these in mind, and I'm sure you'll be able to learn many things today. Ideas for getting to net zero so that recommendations can be made to the town in master plan and other outreach. These are great. So I'm now going to hand things off to Megan, but please keep your responses coming. We have how to refine energy related actions in our ongoing climate energy plan process. Great responses. I'm gonna stop sharing screen, but please feel free to continue to putting everything into the poll. And yeah, I'll let Megan take the lead. Thanks everyone.
Thanks. So we're gonna dive right in, and I'm gonna pass it first over to our Director of Clean Energy here at MAPC, Kemi Peterson, to start us off.
Thanks, Meg, and thanks, Francelles, and thanks to all of you for coming today and sharing your thoughts. We're so glad to see you all from near and far. Meg, why don't you go on to the next slide? So we're all aware here, those of us that are attending this webinar, we're aware of the urgency of the climate crisis and the aggressive and transformative action that's needed to limit warming so that the effects of our changing climate are not catastrophic. We know that's true globally, and it's true here in our backyards. Next slide. Massachusetts has long been a leader, and thank you to our House and Senate reps that are here today and many others that have been working on this for many years. We are guided in our work by the Global Warming Solutions Act and the Green Communities Act, both from 2008, which set forth for that time aggressive goals to curb emissions. And more recently, and in line with international science, the state has increased its goal to net zero by 2050. This was institutionalized this spring by the Next Generation Roadmap Act, which also requires the Commonwealth to reduce emissions below 1990 levels 50% by 2030. So we know we have a lot of work to do in this decade and those to come to change and chart our course forward. Next slide. And we embody this at a regional level. So MAPC just this month adopted its new plan for the region, Metro Common 2050, whereby we call for a region that is climate resilient, net zero carbon, and home to a healthy, clean, and protected environment that centers equity. Next slide. In this work, cities and towns have and will continue to demonstrate important leadership. The Metro Mayors Coalition, which is a collaborative of 15 intercourse cities and towns facilitated by MAPC, the Metro Mayors Coalition committed to become a net zero region by 2050 back in 2016, in the year following the Paris Climate Accord. And that group has made significant strides toward this goal in the years since. Go on to the next slide. Many others in our region and beyond, many of you here today, are doing the work to make this happen. In a scan of publicly available information in 2019, more than one-fifth of our region was developing climate action and net zero plans. One-third had adopted aggressive greenhouse gas reduction goals. And more than two-thirds had committed volunteers or staff dedicated to advancing climate, sustainability, and energy issues. Now, 2 years later, the numbers and the ambition, as well as the urgency, have grown. As cities and towns start to climb out of the pandemic, reckon with racial injustice, and contemplate the promise of new federal dollars, we know that you are also well positioned to serve as the incubators for the innovation, bravery, and smart strategic policy and programs required to realize the healthy and equitable climate future that we need at the pace commensurate with the crisis. And that brings us to why we're all here today, our Municipal Net Zero Playbook. A resource, a blueprint, a guide to turn climate vision and goals into immediate and impactful net zero action. Thank you again so much for attending today, for the work you're already doing, and for what you stand ready to do in the future. We're really excited to share with you our platform for those next steps. I'll send it back to you, Meg.
Thanks, Gabby. So as Cami just mentioned, back in 2018, our team set out to develop a playbook of resources that would really accelerate the necessary actions to achieve our local, regional, and state net zero goals. We saw a gap in what was available to communities at the time, particularly for those who lacked resources and capacity in terms of staff to really undertake a comprehensive climate action planning process on their own. So with the playbook, we wanted to bring together best practices and opportunities for leadership into one cohesive set of resources that really provided the localized context on how municipalities can start to implement these actions. So we hope the playbook will be a resource, not just for municipal planners, energy sustainability staff, but also local volunteers in your community to really understand what actions need to be taken forth, and also a guide for local implementers and those involved in key decision-making processes to know where to go next once you've set that target. So our playbook is comprised of two guiding frameworks and four action-based chapters. And we recommend, you know, starting with the frameworks to really get a sense of how to approach the net zero planning process. And these two resources can be helpful no matter where you're at currently, if you've already made a lot of strides or you're just starting out on your net zero journey. So to support communities in navigating this process, one of the first frameworks that we developed was a framework for action and how to move net zero planning work forward in your community. Each of these stages is informed by best practices that we've seen in communities across the state and also across the country. This process that we've outlined here into four different stages is meant to be a nonlinear process. So you can really start at any of these stages, depending on where you have the most momentum in your community. But a lot of communities will start at this step of pursuing a commitment, which can be an important first step to really rally behind a shared commitment, goal, or target. And so when we're talking about net zero, it's important to understand what that means and what we're talking about. So in MAPC's work with communities, the way that we define net zero and net zero planning is up on the slide. So net zero in this context means reducing greenhouse gas emissions to the greatest extent possible across these primary sectors and balancing out remaining emissions through either greenhouse gas removal or carbon offsets. One way to think about this in terms of net zero is to think about it as a scale where we're minimizing the amount of emissions on the scale and balancing out the rest through that removal of carbon or generation of clean energy. So ultimately, when we're looking at achieving net zero, we want to move from this, where we have a lot of emissions on one side of the scale, to a balanced scale, where we've reduced emissions as much as possible from the main sectors in our communities and increased the amount of clean energy generations and emissions that we're removing from the atmosphere. Another core component of MAPC's framework for action is taking a holistic approach to the planning process within your community. So when we're talking about holistic planning, what we mean here is considering a wide array of the co-benefits associated with different climate actions that you might include in your plan and move forward in your community. So this means moving beyond just thinking about energy and environmental benefits to also thinking about the connections your climate action work has to benefits to the local economy, public health in your community, and equity. So to really support communities specifically in diving into how to think about equity throughout their climate action planning processes, we developed the framework for equity for the playbook. And so the framework for equity provides guidance on how to implement equity at every stage of the planning process in your community. What we've learned over the past 5 years of developing our net zero planning practice with communities is the importance of having these conversations as early on as you can. So we provide guidance in the framework that goes in depth at each of these stages, all the way from budgeting and scoping for your net zero planning project, ultimately to communication of the plan at the end of the process. Within our equity work, it's also very important to be specific about who has been historically disadvantaged by systems of inequity in your community and across the region. So one of the tools that we put forth in the framework for equity is an equity assessment framework. So for each strategy or action that you include in your climate action plan, there are some questions that you can ask, such as who has historically been impacted, who will be most impacted by the changes to our climate that we expect to see in the near term and in the long term, And how will the benefits of this particular strategy or action be distributed to those who are most impacted and have experienced the greatest number of injustices in the past? So with that, we're gonna jump right in and give you a highlight intro to each of the playbook chapters. So I'm gonna turn it over to all my colleagues on the clean energy team to really give you some background on each of those chapters that go into the net zero play. Before we dive in, I wanted to just give some context to what you will see in the chapters and all of the information that's available to you in the playbook. So for each of the chapters, there are between 3 to 4 main strategies that we've developed for communities to apply in their net zero work. And then within each of those strategies, we've identified supporting actions that we really see as best practices or opportunities for leadership in your community. And for each of those actions that's identified in the playbook, you will get a ton of different types of information. This slide kind of shows you all the pieces that you can pull together in the playbook. Our goal with developing this resource was really to focus on the resources and information that will help you move this action forward and implement it in your community. And then more in depth for each action, we provide a breakdown in terms of specific steps that you might take to implement that action in your community, specific guidance around implementing equity through this action, and then some pointers on where you can get started and some resources that you can dive into to really figure out how to make this work in your community. All right, so with that, I'm going to pass it over to Jesse Way to start us off with the Zero Emissions Mobility chapter.
Great, thanks Meg, and hi everyone. My name is Jesse Way, and I'm a clean energy specialist here at MAPC. Today, I will be providing a few highlights from the Zero Emissions Mobility chapter of the playbook. Next slide, please.
Oh, and Jesse, I passed you remote control, so you should be able to advance with your mouse.
Okay, great. So zero emission mobility refers to the movement of people and goods with modes of transportation that emit no emissions, such as biking, walking, and electric vehicles. Decarbonizing mobility is critical to achieving net zero emissions because transportation is one of the two largest contributors of greenhouse gas emissions in most municipalities. In the net zero playbook, we present 4 core strategies to achieve zero emission mobility. You can see them on the slide here. They include supporting walking, biking, and public transportation options, advancing zero emission vehicle infrastructure, encouraging use of zero emission vehicles, and leading by example in your own municipal fleets. All right, so I'm going to walk through 2 strategies from the playbook. The first strategy, as seen on the slide here, is to adopt a complete streets policy. This means committing to the implementation of projects to improve safety and convenience for residents who choose to bike, walk, or take public transportation. These efforts should prioritize considerations for children, older adults, and people with disabilities. By making biking, walking, and public transportation safe and convenient for all, municipalities will make these modes of transportation a viable alternative to inefficient modes of travel, such as trips in single occupancy vehicles. Now, as municipalities work to adopt the complete streets policy, they should consider how to provide equitable access to safe and convenient pedestrian and biking infrastructure. One way to do this is to be thoughtful about the geographic distribution of investments in the infrastructure that supports these modes of transportation. These decisions should be informed by demographic data and contextual information about the neighborhoods in your municipality. Municipalities should also ensure that the types of incentives and supporting equipment for bike share or other micro-mobility options is guided by input from priority populations. This input will help improve accessibility of these modes of transportation to these populations. And just to ensure we're all on the same page, when I use the term micro-mobility, I'm referring to things like bikes and electric scooters. It's really best to think about it as most vehicular modes of transportation that are smaller than motorcycles. In terms of immediate next steps that a municipality can take to implement the strategy, it's a little self-evident here. So we recommend that each municipality develop a local complete streets policy and prioritization plan for investment that aligns with your municipality's net zero goals. If your community has an existing Complete Streets program in place, consider revisions that directly connect to your net zero goals and address micromobility options that may not have been previously incorporated. Moving on to the next slide, the second strategy I will present is to expand the availability of public charging stations. Now, when I say public charging stations, I'm referring to publicly accessible places where people can charge their electric vehicles. And from here on out, I'll refer to electric vehicles as EVs for short, just because it's quicker and also allows you to learn the lingo if you're not already familiar with it. For this strategy, we recommend investing in public EV charging stations in high traffic areas that support longer parking durations, such as libraries, schools, downtown parking garages, and other parking lots. This will allow residents, workers, and visitors to charge their vehicles well away from home. Providing public charging stations gives potential EV drivers more confidence that they will be able to charge their vehicles when they need to, increasing their likelihood of adoption of electric vehicles. From an equity perspective, there are two primary considerations that should guide municipal investments in public charging stations. The first is strategic geographic placement of charging stations, and the second is the adoption of programs to reduce economic barriers to EV adoption. This includes careful consideration of who already has access to charging at home, making them less likely to need the public stations, and also thoughtful decision-making around the appropriate fee to charge for the use of charging stations in different neighborhoods in your municipality. That fee doesn't necessarily need to be the same everywhere. Furthermore, the deployment of charging stations needs to be paired with promotion of available incentives, creation of additional funding support, and potentially the development of local car sharing programs. And just quickly here, immediate next steps for this strategy include selecting appropriate sites and deploying EV charging stations that match the use case of those sites. And I'll lastly just mention that there is funding available for this. More details on that available funding can be found in the Net Zero Playbook. And with that, I'll pass it to my colleague, Brooks.
Thanks, Jesse. Hi, everyone. I'm Brooks Winner, and I'm a senior clean energy specialist at MAPC. I'm the lead author for the buildings chapter of the Net Zero Playbook, and I'm going to walk through some of the highlights of that chapter. So buildings often account for more than 50% of a community's greenhouse gas emissions. So we know that decarbonizing buildings and making them super efficient is key to meeting our climate goals. Buildings are also where we spend most of our time. And as we think about ways to reduce climate pollution from buildings, it's also important that we consider health, housing, and energy cost burdens, and the ways that the climate crisis and the housing crisis are connected to each other. The Net Zero Playbook offers strategies and actions that focus on the interconnectedness of health, housing, and climate issues. The Playbook offers three primary strategies for net zero buildings: reduce greenhouse gas emissions from buildings, electrify new buildings and existing buildings, and advocate for statewide net zero building policies. The first action I want to highlight is create and preserve efficient, affordable housing. Creating and preserving efficient, affordable housing is an important climate action because it provides so many benefits to communities, including lowering housing and energy cost burdens, reducing local greenhouse gas emissions, and improving health for residents and the broader community. From an equity perspective, we know that low-income residents and people of color are most impacted by the climate and housing crises. They also face greater barriers to accessing resources for energy efficiency and other clean energy solutions. So the implementation of this action should prioritize the needs of communities of color to ensure that the benefits of energy and water efficiency are distributed equitably to those who have been historically excluded from these programs and these resources. For next steps, we recommend working with stakeholders to develop a housing production plan that includes ETOD, or equitable transit-oriented development, and prioritizes energy and water efficient design, such as passive house design standards. We also recommend identifying municipally owned land that is suitable for housing development and issuing an RFP or request for proposals to dispose of that land for affordable housing development that is built to high performance standards. And I'll talk about another action that's related to that next. So the next action I want to highlight and a real way for local governments to lead by example is adopting a net zero standard for new municipally owned and funded buildings. So this can include housing funded through an affordable housing trust fund, school buildings, town halls, libraries, and other municipal facilities. For equity considerations, we know that public and private affordable housing have been underfunded for decades, and that low-income residents often live in inefficient, unhealthy housing. The benefits of net zero buildings can be distributed across the entire community if municipal buildings and publicly funded housing are built to net zero standards. For next steps, we recommend researching net zero carbon standards like those adopted by Amherst, Boston, Cambridge, Wayland, and an increasing number of communities across the region, and developing your own draft net zero standard that fits your municipality to introduce at town meeting or before city council within the next year. We think that this is an action that can be implemented in the short term, and it's a great place to start on the buildings front. With that, I'll turn it over to Julie Curdy to take us through the clean energy supply section.
Thanks so much. Brooks. Let me just jump in here. So hi, everyone. I'm Julie Curdy. I'm a clean energy and climate strategy manager and senior planner at MAPC. I'll be talking through some highlights from the clean energy supply chapter in the playbook that I worked on. Let's see here. There we go. So building a clean energy supply means dramatically increasing renewable energy generation use and access. We need a clean and renewable energy supply to reach our goals in the buildings and the transportation sectors that we just talked about. Renewable energy, such as solar and wind, comes from sources that are naturally regenerated in our lifetimes. Renewable energy should also be clean and emit little to no greenhouse gas emissions. We also need to shift to smart and resilient energy infrastructure. At the local scale, this means shifting from our centralized energy grid to one that distributes energy resources across our communities. Smart and resilient energy infrastructure includes energy storage paired with renewables, microgrids, and centralized clean heating and cooling systems. And finally, actions in this chapter, such as demand response programs and repairing major natural gas leaks, share how to reduce carbon in the energy system from the grid to the building scale. I do want to note that many of the actions in this chapter can seem very technology focused, but clean energy technologies should be seen as a means to the end goals we need to reach. So we strongly encourage municipalities to center equity and people in their community as they take on these strategies. When deploying clean energy technologies, for example, there are many ways to ensure that community members can access, benefit, and learn from these projects. And we'll talk about some of the ideas for this in the next two slides, and the chapter has more about equity considerations throughout. So the first of the two strategies from this chapter that we want to highlight is to start a green municipal aggregation program in your municipality. And I'll refer to green municipal aggregation as GMA for short. GMA programs are the most impactful tool we currently have to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in municipalities. They're also a strategy for communities served by investor-owned utilities like Eversource and National Grid, rather than communities served by municipal light plants. In a GMA program, the municipality procures its energy supply on behalf of its residents and small businesses. Energy is still delivered by your utility, but the energy supply comes from contracts set up by the GMA program. And green municipal aggregation programs are very exciting because municipalities can increase the amount of class one renewable energy offered in the program to be higher than what the utility offers. And they can often do this at competitive or even lower prices than what the utility can offer. Adding more high quality renewable energy to GMA programs helps to drive demand for more renewable energy in Massachusetts and in New England. And they also offer the chance for everyone in the community to participate in the clean energy transition. So customers who are on low income rates with the utility maintain that status in a GMA program. And municipalities can also use GMA programs to educate residents about predatory energy supply contracts and to help residents switch to the GMA program whenever possible. And finally, if your municipality already has a green municipal aggregation program, or if you're just starting one, you can keep pushing the program to do more in two ways. The first is to keep increasing the amount of renewable energy in the program, but while also ensuring prices do not become too high for residents. And the second tool is that municipalities can consider having an operational adder in their program. This is typically a very small surcharge, 0.001 cents per kilowatt hour, that ratepayers would pay. Municipalities can petition the Department of Public Utilities to have that adder in their program and to use that money to fund a local sustainability priority, such as a staff position or a clean energy program for lower income residents. And if you want to know more about GMA programs, please reach out to me after this webinar, and I'd be very happy to connect and share more information. And then the second strategy I'd like to highlight from this chapter is to deploy energy storage at critical facilities and to pair these systems with renewable energy generation. Energy storage refers to a suite of technologies, most often different types of batteries, that allow for energy storage to be stored for later use. At the building level, storage can provide demand management services, allowing a building to scale back its grid energy use at peak times and supply energy to the grid when more is needed. Energy storage can also increase resiliency by providing power during outages and make on-site renewable energy more efficient when paired together. When identifying priorities for a project and potential sites, a municipality should consider prioritizing buildings that can serve as emergency shelters and that can provide critical services to community members during extreme weather events, particularly the most vulnerable residents in your community. As a first step, municipalities should convene key staff and partners. This could be planning staff, sustainability staff, the fire and police chiefs, the building inspector, school superintendent, and medical leaders to review priorities for energy storage and discuss potential project sites. And the playbook has several funding resources for energy storage projects that you can check out if this action is of interest. And now I'll pass it over to Sasha to talk about the final chapter.
Great. Thank you, Julie. Let's see. I should be able to advance the slides. Oh, there we go. Hi, everyone. My name is Sasha Scheideroff. I'm a clean energy and climate planner at MAPC, and I'll be talking a bit about climate smart zoning and permitting. This chapter covers strategies that use municipal zoning code and permitting processes to advance your net zero goals. Zoning and permitting are critical municipal tools used by planners to shape the way in which new development and retrofits occur in your community. Buildings built today will last for decades to come, and this strategy provides an opportunity to ensure that new buildings are built for the future. In Massachusetts, municipalities have authority over their local zoning code to manage land use and development for the purposes of health, safety, and welfare. However, the building code and electrical codes are adopted at the state level and enforced locally through inspectional services department. While municipalities cannot regulate buildings in ways that conflict with the building code, they can use their zoning code, development review processes, design standards and guidelines, and permitting processes to help incentivize and advance local net zero goals. The four primary strategies covered in this chapter include allowing net zero, enabling technologies by right, and reducing barriers to using these technologies in the zoning code, establishing climate zoning overlay districts, mandating energy efficiency and renewable energy as appropriate, and streamlining and expediting permitting for net zero. I just also want to note that here, when we talk about net zero enabling technologies, we use it as a catch-all term that describes technologies that either help significantly reduce energy use and increase energy efficiency, allow for structures to avoid on-site combustion of fossil fuels or source renewable energies, or energy storage generated from renewable sources. So the first strategy that I'm gonna talk a little bit about is establishing a climate zoning overlay district. An overlay district is a specific type of zoning regulation that is placed over an existing base code and may follow existing zones or cut across zoning boundaries. This strategy is most useful when thinking about specific geographic regions or land use types in your municipality that you would want to regulate or set performance, energy performance standards for. So for example, thinking about your commercial districts, large multifamily districts, or commercial industrial centers. There are several ways to use an overlay district to advance net zero goals, including setting standards for maximum GHG emissions, establishing a high performance building standard, or incentivizing transit-oriented development. When establishing a climate zoning overlay, you want to consider how these types of regulations will benefit certain people, who they will benefit, and how to ensure that those benefits can be shared by everyone, including low and moderate income residents. And to this end, you may want to consider pairing your climate zoning with affordable housing policies and emphasizing health, safety, and resilience. One of the first steps is to establish a multi-stakeholder committee to review your existing code and establish your zoning objectives and review different types of high performance building standards that may be useful for your community. And just to note, because a question did come up, there is some nuance with the state building code versus zoning code. And if you're setting a high performance building standard, you wanna make sure that that standard has multiple pathways for compliance. And there's lots of examples that we can talk about in the Q&A at the end on how to do that. Let's see. So the next strategy I wanted to talk about is streamlining and expediting permitting. The actions include offering expedited permitting processes, reducing fees, and training municipal inspectional services staff on net zero building standards and design. By providing a transparent, easier, and less expensive permitting process, you can reduce barriers for developers and contractors in this space. This can help reduce costs, which can in turn be passed on to consumers. And it can also help reduce barriers for inspectional services department staff, including the use of staff time. In terms of equity considerations, you might want to consider about how to engage minority and women-led businesses in redeveloping your permitting processes. And immediate steps would be to convene your inspections, zoning, and planning staff to review your existing permitting pathways and establish recommendations. And there are trainings and resources available through MassEEC, MassSave, Built Environment Plus, and SoulSmart. And now I'm going to turn it back to Cami to wrap us up.
Thanks, Sasha, and thanks to everyone on our staff here at MAPC for walking through the different elements of our playbook chapters. A lot of good questions coming in too in the Q&A. Thank you for those and keep those coming. As we load up the slides for our presentation and the great panel that we have here, our municipal panel, I did just want to note that we are only highlighting a few of the strategies and just do not have the time today to get into all the actions under each of those. So please know that what we are discussing is not exhaustive, that there's a lot more in the playbook, and we hope that you'll spend some time exploring that. And that, you know, it is a blueprint for really kind of digging into those next steps, but it is not the end all. So in the playbook, we also point to a number of resources and materials, other tools out there, other use cases that you can look at to kind of further this journey and really allow each community to figure out kind of the next steps in putting together the plan and the implementation. We are very much focused on these plans being actionable and leading to those tangible next steps to reduce your greenhouse gas emissions and take action on climate throughout these different sectors of the economy and of your communities. So today is giving you a sneak preview into what lies ahead, some highlights here and there, but much more to come. And I'm excited, as I know Meg is bringing up the next slides, up here they are, to introduce our municipal panel. So we have many cities and towns that have been leading the way on climate, as I've mentioned previously, and three of our superstars here to tell you a little bit about how they're putting the playbook into action on the ground. So the three that we'll be able to hear from today are Sean Les of the City of Framingham. He's our sustainability coordinator for Framingham, Martha Grover, the sustainability manager for the City of Melrose, and Arena Keefe, the sustainability director from the City of Beverly. So Sean, I'm happy to hand the reins to you so we can hear about how Framingham is putting one similar strategy into action.
Thank you, Cammie. Really appreciate it. So I will just get my slides ready. Perfect. So as Cammie mentioned, my name is Sean Luz. I'm sustainability coordinator for the City of Framingham, and I'm really happy to be here today to present to you, you know, as part of the launch of the playbook. And so I believe some of my team may be in attendance as well. So I just want to give a quick special shout out to Frank Nikashian, who works now in the town of Waltham, formerly the sustainability coordinator in Ashland that helped launch the program. Jillian Wilson-Martin, sustainability director from the town of Natick, and also Matt Zedek, sustainability consultant for the town of Holliston. They're all part of the team that have helped develop and continue to manage this program. So the Metro West Solar and Clean Heat Challenge is a multi-community campaign that was launched earlier this year to provide an option for residents and small businesses to adopt solar and clean heating and cooling technologies in our communities. As many of you may be familiar, the MassCEC Solarize program was a huge inspiration for the launch of this effort. When it was learned that funding for the program wouldn't be available in 2021, the town of Ashland began work on the idea of a community-led energy program and then worked to tie in the communities of Framingham, Holliston, and Natick. So in a nutshell, our four municipalities developed an RFP building upon the Solarize Plus program to procure installers of clean energy technologies to serve local residents and businesses. Through the program, we selected installers to provide no-cost assessments and discounted pricing for clean energy technologies to members of the community who sign up on our website, which is metrowestcleanenergy.com. The program offers three primary technologies, solar photovoltaics, air source heat pumps, as well as ground source heat pumps or geothermal. In developing the program, we spent a great deal of time evaluating proposals from clean energy installers, assessing their competitiveness, level of customer service, the equipment that they propose to utilize, as well as their capacity to support the potential intake of leads from other communities. My apologies. So with the program up and running, municipal staff and volunteers in each of the communities, including myself, have been conducting local outreach to support the program and more generally educate our residents about how they can adopt clean energy solutions for their home or business. And so underlying the program's development, an important part of our education efforts has been conveying why our communities joining forces to work on this. And so as you can see here on this slide, as demonstrated by Natick's greenhouse gas emissions inventory, how we heat, cool, and power our homes, unsurprisingly, represents a major source of our greenhouse gas emissions. And this is representative across our communities. In this case, in Natick's case, it's 62% of their total greenhouse gas emissions. So with similar results across our communities, we saw that this could be a great way to advance our goals, our individual climate goals that we have in each of our communities, reduce our greenhouse gas emissions, and also help us support the state's decarbonization roadmap. In particular, in Framingham, you know, this was a great effort for us to follow up on some energy efficiency outreach and engagement that we've been doing the last few years. It looked like a very significant way that we could help support the transition to clean energy locally. And while all that sounds great, for many residents and businesses, the process to transition to these technologies, of course, can be unfamiliar and can sometimes be overwhelming. And so there's a lot to learn and consider for a homeowner that might be considering, you know, installing a solar PV system, or maybe even, you know, replacing their heating or cooling system and getting an air source or ground source heat pump. So our goal with the program was to specifically address some of these major challenges. So we saw this effort is more than just an isolated issue. With the communities working together, we wanted to take a regional approach to promoting clean energy technologies. As a community based initiative, we wanted to leverage these sources, to engage and educate our members about how clean energy technologies can benefit them. And we also wanted to build on successful programs like the Solarize program from the Mass EC, which I also want to send thanks to as well for their guidance as we were getting configured. And we want to empower residents and businesses about the options that they have available. And so just to very quickly just show some of the outreach we did. We did all sorts of events, a clean energy brew fest. We tabled at different events, sent out mailers, and had online webinars, which we continue to do. And our progress to date, you can see here, over 500 signups in the program and a number of contracts for the different technologies. So it's been a very exciting and great program. And to close things out, you can check it out yourself on the website, metrowestcleanenergy.com, and looking forward to the Q&A. Thank you.
Thanks, Sean. And we'll pass it next to Martha Grover. Martha, take it away.
Thanks, everyone. I want to first just say thank you to the MAPC Clean Energy team for their expertise and assistance with our Net Zero Action Plan over the last couple of years. We're in the final approval stages, but we've already started the work on our action items. And one action item is encouraging more residents to make their next vehicle purchase electric. And in support of that, we jumped on the opportunity to partner with National Grid on a demonstration project to install electric vehicle chargers on utility poles along streets and in lots in Melrose. So I'm just going to quickly go through this, and my contact information is here in case anybody has any follow-up questions. And I also just want to say that this is relevant to everyone here because National Grid, based on the success of this project, is proposed rolling it out in 10 more communities. And if you're in Eversource territory or some other utility, you should ask them about it as part of their Make Ready incentive program. So Meg, do I have? There we go. So like in many of our communities, this is, you know, electric vehicle adoption is increasing every year at a very fast pace, but we're still at 1% of registered vehicles, but we expect that to grow over time. We have two existing EV chargers before this project started, two ground-mounted chargers that we installed in 2014 and 17 using EVIP funding. And we ran into some issues with finding more locations to install EV chargers ground mounted. So this demonstration project was a great opportunity to, as the in the benefits description here, to target hard to reach areas that we found source of power was far away, would require lots of trenching, expensive digging and installation costs. We also were looking to lower the complexity and cost through this demonstration project and also make the EV chargers more public and visible to folks who are driving around town to make it seem, to encourage them to see how accessible EV chargers are. So these chargers are located 10 feet up on the pole and at eye level, and I'll show you, there's another slide later that shows how they use. When the equipment is activated, the EV charge cord lowers. They're 20 feet long and can reach any port on car parked at the pole. One of the things that we did learn through this is that it's not suitable for every pole, and the poles have to have sufficient clearing and limited existing attachments. So the partners in this project obviously were National Grid through their Make Ready program, EVSE, which is the equipment manufacturer, part of Control Mod, having trouble going back to the partner. Voltrek did the installation. AmpUp is the software and network software that's loaded up on these. And of course the poles are jointly owned by Verizon and National Grid. So we did have to jump through a few hoops with Verizon as well. So these are some examples of poles where it doesn't work. It's just jumping ahead. Anyway, dual poles or poles that have a lot of equipment attached to them. There's a map coming up of where we were able to install these. The green ones are the existing poles, existing EV chargers, and then we spread these out around town. This is how it works. There's a QR code, or you have the AmpUp software, and the cord comes down and you just charge your car. These are 9 kW chargers, so they're faster than our existing charge point equipment. And then when you're done, about 30 seconds later, it retracts into the pole. So as of last Tuesday, all 15 new chargers were installed on 9 poles. Our traffic commission recently approved making all of the parking at all of these chargers EV only, which I think will really increase the usage of these. We do need to increase signage. And so there's an example of one of this piece of equipment in LA, and we want to, the signage that they've installed there, we really like, we want to copy that. And it also is part of our project now to just increase general outreach and raise awareness of these. But so far, so good. So happy to answer any questions. Thanks. And introducing Arena from Beverly.
Thank you, Martha. And hi, everybody. My name is Arena Key from the Sustainability Director with the City of Beverly. So I'm here to kind of share a little bit about our journey installing solar to meet nearly all of our municipal building needs here in Beverly. I took this photo that you see in the slide in August during a site visit of our 5-megawatt solar development, where a capped landfill now hosts ground-mounted solar. And it was absolutely buzzing with life, lots of red clover, bees, monarch butterflies, and it makes me wish that these photos had audio. So for some context, this summer we wrapped up our joint climate action and resilience plan called Resilient Together in partnership with the City of Salem. So both cities are committed to the city's race to zero. So we have this shared goal of reducing GHGs by 50% by 2030, and also track with the state goals that Cami had described earlier. And one of our 5 energy goals was to have regional clean energy supplying our kind of municipal asset operations by 2030 and our community energy by 2040. This could mean using, you know, Massachusetts Class 1 RECs in our community aggregation, as Julie explained, but Mayor Cahill in Beverly is deeply committed to getting every panel of solar on city property that we can, so that we can do our part to minimize our emissions locally. So we are up to a lot of good work in sustainability space. Here I'm just giving an overview of our solar projects that are essentially going to generate enough electricity to cover all the needs of our buildings. So looking back, we have a history long history of solar in Beverly. It was actually one of the 8 sites in the US that President Carter had selected for solar panels back in 1981. And it's the only one that's still up and running. It has required quite a bit of, you know, maintenance over the years, some replacement of original inverters and panels. But it is kind of going to serve as an interesting vestige of technology as we seek to update the array next year. And then the next project, so this is a total of 7.5 megawatts across these three projects. And in 2014, we built out 2.6 megawatts of ground-mounted solar at our airport property. This was applied to our high school accounts, our streetlights, and one of our pump stations as well. And then in 2020, so just last year, a nearly 5 megawatt community solar project was built on that capped landfill. So you can see the before and after picture on the left. And that was when, so at the time, all this happened while I was not at the city, but at the time this process started way back in 2014 when Mayor Cahill started his administration. So once a lease and a power purchase agreement were signed with the first vendor, the developer's financing fell through and the project essentially fell apart until it was picked back up again. A new site was found and a replacement vendor was identified. So there were also some kind of private property access issues that took some substantial negotiation and some outside counsel to resolve. But it is now 2021 and credits for community solar started rolling in earlier this year. So today we have 100 shares of Beverly residents signed up for a program. It did sell out very quickly. So I do wish we had more shares to offer to folks because it does seem to be a really popular offering, especially for those who can't have solar on their rooftops. So I'm working through some complications now with the kind of confusing billing process of how the essentially 10% discount is realized by residents. So for this project, the city purchases over a third of the generation. We're serving as an anchor institution and applying it to our school accounts. And moving forward, we are advancing a really exciting and kind of complex solar project across 8 publicly owned sites with our developer and really an excellent project partner, Kearsarge Energy. This is a combination of parking lot, ground-mounted solar, and rooftop canopy, as you can see in the slide. We did issue on RFP. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm missing some text there. So we issued this RFP for the project about 3 years ago, and still we haven't received final costs from the utility. One of the biggest challenges for this project has been interconnection. We originally anticipated something to the effect of $400,000 in costs to interconnect to the grid for those first 7 sites, and we were quoted at over $1 million. So this included upgrades like 3V0 protection at one of our substations, which as it turns out, Beverly was in the queue for in a couple years anyway. So it has taken quite a bit of effort with some key National Grid staff members to try to reduce these costs and keep the project alive. And ultimately it is alive. The projects have gone in front of school committee, conservation commission. The mayor has played a really significant role in prioritizing this with the utility and with other department heads, you know, thinking for the fire department, can the trucks make this really tight turning radius in a city parking lot? What are the access points to the roof of these buildings? And right now we're just working through a custom foundation design for some of the sites to prevent subsidence as was deemed necessary by our geotechnical analysis. So we are still targeting the summer 2022 for construction. Timing is really everything. We can't disrupt students during the school year. So we really have to start construction in June, end it in August. And as many of you have encountered with manufacturing delays and supply chain issues, we're making sure that we're on top of everything that we can control. So I know in general, it can be kind of frustrating that everything moves more slowly than the urgency that we know and that we feel is needed for us to meet our climate goals, but we're on the right track. So thank you for giving me the opportunity to share.
Great, thank you so much to all three of our panelists here for sharing how they're really taking action on the ground. And we really wanted to highlight, I know in a very short time available, but just give a quick highlight of the fantastic work that they're doing. And we have just a few minutes here to answer some of the questions that have popped up in the Q&A around these specific projects and more generally the work that they're doing. So I think I might take a question that was originally posed directly to Arena, but also kind of open it up for the three of you. And Arena, the question for you was around whether there were any solar shares in that community shared solar site for low and moderate income residents. So that'd be great to hear your response on that. And then Martha and Sean, it would also be great just to hear about, there were some other questions about community engagement and input from those in the community on how you've been able to bring in voices or what the process has been for those projects to allow the community to have some input or how you're thinking about doing that in the future. So over to you first, Arena, and then we'd love to hear thoughts from Martha and Sean as well.
Thank you. And to my knowledge, no, we don't have shares specifically for low-income residents. I know this is one of the barriers that came up by one of our city councilors was flagging that a credit check is necessary in order to sign up for community solar. So she's recognized that that's, you know, a major barrier to some folks being able to participate in the program. I think we are among one of the first, I think there's three other communities that are including community solar in our aggregation. And we'll see, that's currently in state review right now. It's been in review for almost 10 months now, and we haven't really been moving forward. So that seems like we're gonna have to delay our program launch by another year, and hopefully we'll have some community solar available then.
Great, thanks very much. Martha, Sean, any thoughts on how you've been able to involve the communities in the projects you spoke to today?
Sean, you wanna take that?
Yeah, sure. So I think, you know, it's definitely been an important part of the program in each of the communities. I think that, you know, it's a regional program, but I think within each community, there has to be specific strategies that you employ to try to, you know, reach out to different groups of people. And so, you know, for example, one of the things that we saw was that, you know, doing a specific event in one community might not be as effective in another community at generating signups for no cost assessments through the program. And so we've really been relying on our local volunteers, members of our sustainability committees to help, you know, maybe guide what are effective events that we can table at, or like just ways that we can reach people. So I would say, yeah, it's been a, you know, huge part of that. And also volunteers were part of our process and, you know, choosing installers and, you know, really ramping up the program as it started. So, yeah.
And I can just say that in terms of our pole mounted chargers, first, in terms of just selecting poles and locations, we were looking, the goal was to try to have them all be within half a mile of each other. Melrose, just for those of you who haven't been here before, is less than 5 square miles in size. So we're pretty small. I think we're the second smallest city geographically in the state. And so we're looking to get them scattered around town within, you know, maybe a 10-minute walk of most places, and trying to also focus on multi-unit dwellings. And so we ran into some issues with the wrong kinds of poles being in those areas near our apartment buildings. But we did our best to find good poles near those locations. One of the things that we had to do in this process was, it was our traffic commission who oversees the right of way and had to approve the installation of these chargers on streets. And in that process, they notified abutters of all of the proposed locations. And interestingly, I heard the same feedback from Los Angeles, where this equipment is also installed. They have about 250 of these installed. And they got some of the same feedback, which is that in highly residential areas where people are very cognizant of who's parking in front of their homes, what we heard and what they heard was they didn't want filling stations in front of their houses. So we heard that loud and clear, and as a result ended up with locations that are in more publicly accessible areas where the neighborhood or the abutters and businesses are used to, you know, cars that they're not familiar with parking in the street. So recreation areas, business districts outside of our main area, parks, fields, et cetera.
Great. Thank you to the three of you for more insight into the challenges and some of the ways that you have been working to mitigate those challenges. Another question came up, and again, I think this can be applied a little bit more broadly, but you know, in thinking about how to get buy-in from local leadership. So please feel free to speak directly to these projects or kind of more generally in related projects, but wondering, you know, what you found to be effective in the discussions that you've had, the arguments that you've made in convincing leaders, staff, or the community to buy into the fact that there's, you know, there's something you need to solve for or changes that you need to make or new projects or strategies you need to roll out that might be very focused on climate and sustainability. And maybe I'll throw this open if someone wants to jump in.
I can provide some thoughts on that. I think, you know, one of the major things that I found is trust. I think that, you know, when there's a program or some type of initiative that is brought forward by a municipality, you know, residents in the community are going to be looking to, you know, the municipality is a trusted source of either information of or, you know, whatever the program's providing. And in our case, with this program, you know, we took a significant amount of time, you know, vetting different steps of the process. And I think that was really important because it makes us feel confident that, you know, as we're going through and, you know, getting people to sign up, you know, we have that constant dialogue with clean energy installers that we work through in the program, as well as, you know, our residents that we're checking in with. So I would say, you know, especially when you're talking to leadership to start something like this, you know, you want to make sure that you've done your homework about your specific community and that you have safeguards or you just demonstrate that, you know, there's a very fine attention to detail to the program you're implementing. Because ultimately, you know, trust is one of the most important assets that you can have as, you know, representing the municipal government. You want to make sure that you're not doing things to put that at risk.
Yeah, and I would just say that along with the trust is, you know, the having the municipality being a good solid source of information. So I'm not talking about our EV charger project, but Melrose ran a heat smart campaign in 2020, and we've done Solarize, we've done the, you know, the Mass Save community initiatives for home energy assessments. And what we have found is that having coaches, having people who are available to residents with good source of information. I mean, our Solarize program ran in 2012, and our Melrose Solar Coach still gets at least 2 calls or emails a week from residents. I held an event last week because we just renewed our Green Municipal Aggregation program, and everybody who came to this virtual session really had no questions about our electricity program because it's been in place for 6 years already. They all wanted to know, I'm on oil, how do I get off? There's just a lot of handholding. And that's one of the things that you know, I'm really pushing for here in order to roll out our net zero action plan is the need for coaches. And I think that the days of volunteer coaches are really behind us. We cannot do this revolution on the backs of volunteers. We need to have staff. We need to have paid people who are well-trained to do the handholding, to provide the reliable information to residents who are all coming at this from different places. So I think that that's very key. They need someone that they can call, that they trust, as Sean said, to give them good information.
Thanks to both of you for those responses. And I'll say that your response there, Martha, also is applicable to some of the questions that we got around staff and capacity. There are, you know, a number of communities throughout the Commonwealth, certainly in this region and at this webinar today, that don't have dedicated staff at the municipal level to support these programs. And so some questions around, you know, can volunteers do this? Can community, you know, groups do this? And we've certainly seen that. You know, we've worked with a number of communities over the years that have gotten you know, quite a lot done with having, you know, volunteers that are very dedicated. But to the point that you're making, to really be able to, you know, take this the next step, to really implement the level and scale that we need, we are seeing more and more communities take on funded positions, and more communities look to having, you know, funded coaches or liaisons or other technical assistance and support out there. So it seems the more that we really look to kind of transform the way our cities and towns are working on energy and sustainability, the more we'll need the staff to support that. And obviously at MAPC and other regional planning agencies, we're here to support as well as our, you know, other programs throughout the state. But the more that we've seen dedicated staff in our communities, the more that they are generally able to do. Well, certainly you spoke to Arena before you were on board in Beverly, that the city still moved a lot of this forward and has had many successes. So we certainly see that as well. One last question here, I think, as we're coming down on time, but there's a question that came in that was kind of pointing forward to the future. And so I would love to hear kind of where you see these projects going in order to scale them up. And I'll see if I can find it here. There was one specifically to you, Sean, kind of about you know, where you see this going next. And I'm not going to be able to bring it up in time. But, you know, speaking about, you know, the all three of you in the projects here spoke to, one, some of the time and taking to get these programs together. Two, kind of the great success you've now had in kind of seeing some of those results, the polls up, you know, the communities involved and the effects you're seeing on the ground, Sean, the solar that you have been able to deploy, Arena. But would you both or all three speak to, you know, where you see this going in the next, you know, 5-10 years as we look to meet the state and local climate goals that we have? How do you take these programs that we spoke to today and really kind of help them to get more of the scale that they'll need? And maybe I'll start with you, Arena.
Yeah, that's a great question. It makes me think of just grid modernization. So we talk a lot about building electrification. I know I didn't touch on that in this presentation, but as we try to get more renewables connected to the grid, as we try to install more electric vehicle charging infrastructure community-wide, we really need to focus on upgrading the grid and making sure that there are no, that the barriers are not just solely just financial and cost and trying to get the utility to kind of negotiate on every point. So I see that as being really critical moving forward. But I hope with every project that it just becomes easier for another community to do the same thing. I know precedents are gold, and we often look to what all of you, the other communities, have done, borrowing ordinance language, calling for references. And I think those resources make it just easier for the next one to get it done.
That's great. Martha, any thoughts?
Well, I totally agree. And, you know, I am here and I talk to other volunteers and folks from other communities all the time, and I'm happy to help people. I this dynamic of the haves and the have nots, the communities that have these positions and those that don't, I really think are, we need to resolve that, because having a position like this really does make a difference in getting this work done. And I followed closely the 3-year planning process. And I just really think that the change that came out of that, the change in the incentives and I already got a glimpse of the heat smart incentives or the heat pump incentives for 2022. It's a game changer. I mean, I think we can all of a sudden consider ground source heat pumps for our library project. I mean, it's the change in these incentives that are being proposed for the next 3 years are really going to give us the tools. And I, you know, we're National Grid has got this new Community First program. I don't know whether it's available in other utility territories, but they are in this program. It's the community initiative. They are funding advisors, coaches, and it's a pretty good chunk of change that would really help us reach our goals. So I think all of that is important, having those tools. The roadmap is a game changer, the next gen roadmap that passed earlier this year.
Thanks, Martha. And yes, the Community First program is available within Eversource and National Grid territory. So a really nice evolution of that program that we've seen. Sean, final thoughts on this, on scaling up?
Yeah, I just wanted to echo a couple of points made by past speakers. I mean, I think it's an excellent point that communities often build off of what other communities are doing. Like that's how this program started, you know, working on the Solarize program and other programs that Massachusetts municipalities have done. And so, you know, I think that's going to be a huge step, not just the isolated work that we're doing, but the work we can do together by, you know, kind of utilizing each other's research and all that. So that's a really important point. And I think outside of that as well, I guess just specifically for our program, you know, we're going to be doing a deep dive into all the data as we close out this year. But, you know, we're excited and looking toward the future with all the new incentives that are out for heat pumps. This, you know, it's great timing right now with all those coming out, and we still have this program underway. So we're going to be reviewing and hopefully, you know, bringing something back next year to take advantage of that and hopefully get some more clean heating and cooling deployed, as well as more solar installations. So very excited.
Fabulous. Well, thank you so much to the three of you. Thank you to Sean, to Martha, and to Arena for sharing their insights into these particular projects and the work they're doing more broadly. Really excited to see the playbook actions and strategies put into action on the ground and the local change that we can implement through strategies such as these. So with that, I will turn it back over to Meg and Aki to close out our webinar today.
Thanks, Cami. All right, so not too much to close out on. I wanna thank everyone who presented on the webinar today and also everyone who listened in for their morning on a Monday. If you wanna explore the playbook in full, you can check out our resources at mapc.org/net-0/playbook. Also, if you go to our Net Zero site, there's a whole backlog of Net Zero planning resources that can help you out as you're thinking through your Net Zero planning process. We will also have a toolkit that we'll send around that you can use to share this on social media. We want you to share this resource with your colleagues and with others who you think would benefit from accessing the playbook. We've also got a ton of information in the Q&A and the chat directly from all of you. So after the Thanksgiving holiday, we'll also circulate the recording along with information that folks have shared and the answers to questions that we've answered throughout the webinar. So again, thank you all so much for joining. We hope that the playbook will be useful as you all move forward in taking action locally on climate.